Good morning.
Good morning.
What are the stories of hope which the UU Service Committee offers each year during the Guest at Your Table annual fund drive? Pictures of those that are being honored and featured this year on that large poster. They focus on individuals and organizations working hard to create healthy environments, sustainable livelihoods, and lasting positive change. They connect us with people around the world and inspire us to support these programs to share our wealth. This year, Guest at Your Table highlights the empowerment of refugees and displaced people, those who are most overlooked or discriminated against in the midst of humanitarian crisis. There are three stories in the booklet you'll be receiving later in the service. I've chosen the story of one Honduran mother and her young son who fled to this country seeking refuge and hope. Hope, a four-letter word used to express an expectation of fulfillment of something better to come. That is the theme of this talk. Our assistance to homeless families through Interfaith Hospitality offers them hope. We provide some financial support to the House of Hope, which features some facilities for the homeless families during the day. It also has a food pantry and has social services. Betty is a very active volunteer at House of Hope, which is located in Toms River next to the Presbyterian Church. How does it feel to not have a home? When my children were young, we had to suddenly flee from our home because of a violent situation. And I came very close to being homeless. It's a terrible, terrible feeling. It's thanks to members of my church and some close friends that I found shelter. Actually, initially moving into an abandoned house with the four children and working from there. But I understand to a deeper level, perhaps, how terrible it is, particularly if you have children you're responsible for. Sadly, many must leave their homes due to a threat of violence, perhaps even forced to leave their country. Today, I share a story of one mother who took the precarious journey with her son from the Honduras to save them both from violence. But their confinement at an immigration detention facility set up by our ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, in Texas, was no safe haven until UU social service workers partnered with a grassroots organization intervened. This is the story of Lillian Castillo and her picture. And I'm so grateful to both Linda and Frank for managing to get that picture on the order of service. Her picture and her son's there. Lillian told the aid workers that 8-year-old Jose lost his childhood in that center. Here she describes her appalling experience. For 10 months, we were locked in the Karnes County Detention Center. It was like a prison camp, surrounded by razor wire fencing, a frightening environment for me, and even more so for my child. There was malnutrition, inadequate medical care, 10 months of abuse, and the threat of solitary confinement in the cold room if we didn't conform. 10 months of living with the fear of sexual assault by the guards. Treatment so unconscionable that it provoked at least one suicide attempt. It drove many of us women to go on a hunger strike in protest. That was featured in the newspaper a while ago. Lillian said, for 10 months, I almost lost hope for our future. I'd like to read a press release from UUSC, which was issued last month concerning these detention facilities. Mothers and children asylum seekers being held in U.S. detention centers are experiencing complex trauma disorder and interrelated health risks. Their conditions, say the team of psychologists, is due in part to traumas experienced on U.S. soil at the hands of those the refugees have turned to for protection. There is overwhelming evidence that the U.S. is violating the human rights of these Central American refugees at the Dilley and Carnes Family Detention Centers in South Texas. The abuses by the privately owned detention centers have been chronicled across national media with reports of sexual abuse, lack of medical care, threats of deportation, obstructing detainees' rights of access to legal counsel, and even threats of separating mothers and their children. This is in our facility. These exceptionally vulnerable, traumatized people are subjected to human rights abuses that are endemic in how the U.S. is criminalizing the asylum process, said UUSC's president, Reverend William Schultz. The trauma of fleeing violence from their homeland, plus the traumas during their dangerous flights to asylum in this country, was heightened once they arrived and placed in these harsh U.S. border holding facilities. Cells are infamously referred to as carreras and jaleras, dog kennels and ice boxes. The first step in seeking asylum while you're in the detention facility is a credible fear hearing, which to me is so ironic because it applies, of course, to why they had to leave their native country. And yet, in a sense, right now in some of the detention centers, that would apply to where they are staying. Oh, I got my pages backwards. Fear with me. How sad that Lillian and Jose came to this country in search of sanctuary, but were met instead with cruelty and abuse at the hands of our own government. Finally, hope arrived via the UU Service Committee. Their partnership with the Refugee and Immigration Center for Education and Legal Services, it's a long name, and it's RAICES, R-A-I-C-E-S, provided legal and casework assistance to thousands of mothers like Lillian, caught in the immoral machinery of the broken U.S. immigration system. They helped these refugees assert their rights and navigate ICE's complex legal and bureaucratic rules. Once women and children are released, the organization also connects them with local families for temporary housing and support before they are reunited with relatives elsewhere in the U.S. The lawyer which RAICE provided helped Lillian convince a judge to release her and Jose after 10 months, finally offering hope that she did have a chance here in our country. Today, she and her son are living in New York with her sister. Lillian said, "I now see the happiness in my son's eyes. I don't think I've ever seen that happiness before. I want to keep moving forward. I know that everything will fall into place." So Lillian did not give up hope. And we have an opportunity, of course, to provide hope for people like this, and people in other circumstances. And right now, I'm going to ask Audrey and Betty. Audrey has a basket that has your pamphlets in it. It also has mini chocolate bars. And we're having a mini chocolate communion here. So what I ask is that once you have received the pamphlet and the chocolate bar, you hold on to the chocolate so that we can all enjoy it together at the end of the service. Now the other stories in this booklet, there are three different stories. The first begins 75 years ago at UUSC's inception, when UU minister Reverend Sharp and his wife Martha traveled to Europe to help evacuate children at risk during World War II. Two of those children, Alex Strasser and Catherine Bakar, were among those rescued through the Sharps' efforts. Both became U.S. citizens, attended our universities, raised families, and stayed in touch with the Sharps. Kathy has never forgotten her good fortune, noting that she owes Martha her life in America, perhaps life itself. In the third story, a Philippine public health nurse, Irish Grace, was one of the first to participate in UUSC efforts following the devastation created by Typhoon Haiyan in November of 2013, in partnership with the nonprofit Trauma Resource Institute and UUSC. Training was offered to give first responders and caregivers the tools they need to help displaced communities recover. After that training, Irish Grace put together her own team, training more than 100 community workers. So the ripple in the pond is ever widening. Our programs through UUSC are in our country, Haiti, Guatemala, Peru, Argentina, Uganda, Tanzania, Kenya, Nepal, and the Philippines. It helps safeguard young women from sex trafficking in Kenya, helps struggling families in Haiti rebuild their lives, and protects an indigenous community's clean drinking water in Guatemala. So we truly are having an effect in our own small, somewhat modest way through this wonderful program. And this is the time each year, and there we go again. Thanks, Jim. So the chocolate is from Equal Exchange. I place orders with Equal Exchange. It's another program sponsored by UUSC that supports farmers in different parts of the world, providing organic food and harvesting it in a sustainable way. Our church serves Equal Exchange coffee. And when we were in Toms River and had the facilities, we had a little store where we stocked coffee, tea, and chocolate, and you could buy it there. But you could easily go online to Equal Exchange and get it there as well. I don't have a chocolate. Here. So this might seem just a little corny, but now I invite you all to take your chocolate, open it, and savor the sweetness that we have in having homes and having safety. Enjoy. I do want to mention that this envelope is self-explanatory. You make a donation directly to UUSC, simply put it in this envelope. You can use a credit card or a check, or you can even go online and do it. But be sure not only to mention your name, but this congregation. And the reason for that is that UUSC is having their 75th anniversary. And they have said that any congregation that has either top fundraising or top member participation will be included in the anniversary time capsule. And the capsule will be marked for opening in 2040 for their 100th anniversary. So wouldn't it be grand if UUSC, because we have really responded to this appeal, can be included in that time capsule. And in conclusion, I would say remember, there is another four-letter word that begins with H. It's help. When we help, we offer hope.
Thank you, Nancy.